Good to have everyone back. Hope you've had a good afternoon, enjoyable day, a beautiful day out. The Royals won, still in first place, so makes it a good day too. Good that we can be together again this evening. Sometime during his third missionary journey, Paul began a project that would occupy him for at least several months, if not several years. The project was a collection of relief for the churches in the Judea-Jerusalem area. We don't know exactly the circumstances concerning the needs of the Jerusalem church. We don't know if it was maybe a famine in Palestine or whether that was all or part of the problem. Some commentators suggest even that the selling of personal property that we read about in Acts chapter 2 was so radical that 30 years later, the Jerusalem Christians had not yet recovered economically from their generosity at that time. Another possibility, and probably these all could combine and be shared explanations, but another possibility was the outcast status of Christians in Jerusalem. Many converts, most converts, at least originally in Jerusalem, maybe most even thereafter, were of Jewish origins. When they converted to Christianity, as the separation between Christianity and Judaism became more pronounced, they would have been more and more rejected by their family and friends for having renounced Judaism, becoming Christians. That would have brought on significant economic repercussions. We're going to see a little bit later that the same social exclusion probably hit converts in other areas as well, which would lend support to the theory that that was part of the problem in Judea. At any rate, the need was real, and this collection was an ongoing sideline, if you will, for Paul for an extended period of time. Eventually, he would enlist support from churches in all of the areas where he had worked and had some direct personal contacts. Specifically mentioned are Achaia, which includes Corinth, and we'll be in 2 Corinthians tonight, would have included Macedonia, and it included Galatia. Those are ones that are specified in one passage or another. Whether the church in Rome participated in this collection or not, we don't know, but Paul made sure that at least they knew something about the effort. Paul's writings about this relief effort constitute most of the information that we have today to guide us in what we call the Sunday collection or the offering. If Paul hadn't been doing that collection, we wouldn't have any passages to give us guidance concerning our own giving and Sunday collection efforts. As we approach the passage and related passages on giving this evening, I challenge us to read Paul's words with a clear separation between what Paul was doing and saying and our modern day fundraising methods. Modern fundraising has developed in such a way that it breeds cynicism, or at least it causes me to be very cynical about a lot of fundraising. It's not that there are no causes worth raising funds to support. There are certainly good causes and ones that we should and can consider supporting. But the fundraising culture can taint even the most noble causes, not to mention the less noble causes. We've all received fundraising appeals. We get them on the phone, we get them in the mail, we get them in email. And here's one I have to share with you, if for no other reason, that the email came while I was writing this sermon. I felt it, you know, came at a really appropriate time. This was an offer to help, I'm not sure, to help us or to help me raise funds. I'll share the first paragraph with you. I Googled for churches and found your website. I thought you might have an interest in selling videos, audio files, books, and other digital content online. For example, and this is in their text. For example, your members could sign up for a weekly subscription for sermons. Is this not an idea whose time has come? Just think, you could come to church, hear the sermon for free, and then pay to get reruns. They'll try it. We have received enough of these appeals from one source or another to recognize the standardized techniques and gimmicks that are used in the fundraising industry. There are the guilt or sense of obligation appeals. This is such a good cause, and all of your neighbors are participating. Surely you don't want to be the only selfish penny pincher in the neighborhood. They don't say it quite that way, but that's what they make you feel like they have said. And then there's the letter informing you of the dire financial straits of this world-saving organization. If they don't receive a certain amount of donations by a certain date, they might have to curtail services. The letter and the brochure that came with it were obviously produced by a professional fundraising consultant firm and cost several thousand dollars that have to be covered before any of the donations actually go to the cause for which they are soliciting. And then there's the tried and true matching funds appeal. I say all of that because of the influence our culture has on us. We are accustomed, like it or not, we're at least accustomed to that style of fundraising. And it may be that we are very cynical because of it as well. And then we read what Paul wrote about the collection that he was managing. And we risk seeing Paul as sort of the prototype for the gimmicks and manipulation that are so prevalent today. So that's my challenge for us this evening. Let's try to remember that Paul wasn't a part of that. Paul wrote long before fundraising consultants were invented. We should not assume that he is using some of the same techniques in their first century form. It's just possible that what Paul wrote about this collection was just as pure and just as genuine as what he wrote on other spiritual topics. Here's how we'll look at these early verses of 2 Corinthians chapter 8 tonight. We'll start with the background of the Corinthian connection to Paul's collection project. Then we'll see how he is presenting a philosophy of Christian giving rather than techniques for fundraising. We'll take a look at the situations in Macedonia and in Corinth, and finally we'll look at the subject of grace and fellowship that are present in this passage about giving and the collection for the Jerusalem saints. Some background to the Corinthian relationship to the collection should be useful for us. As is often the case, though, it may be impossible to perfectly reconstruct all of the day-to-day details of the situation, but a general picture should be within reach. From what Paul says in this chapter, we know that the Corinthian church had known about this collection for at least a year. In 2 Corinthians 8, verse 10, he writes, "And in this I give advice, it is to your advantage not only to be doing what you began and were desiring to do a year ago." So we know that they knew about it a year earlier. And in chapter 9, verse 2, "For I know your willingness, about which I boast of you to the Macedonians, that Achaia was ready a year ago, and your zeal has stirred up the majority," remembering that Corinth was the primary church in the area of Achaia that he mentions there in verse 2 of chapter 9. Obviously, their contribution for this effort was not completely ready a year later, as he refers to it. The phrase about being ready a year ago probably means that it was a year ago that they had made a commitment to participate. They were ready to be a part of this. We also know that Paul gave them instructions about how to proceed with the collection. And it's these instructions that are probably the most often read passage on the topic of our offering, from over in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, the first two or three verses, where there he writes in 1 Corinthians, "Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given orders to the churches of Galatia, so you must do also. On the first day of the week, let each one of you lay something aside, storing up as he may prosper, that there be no collections when I come. And when I come, whomever you approve by your letters, I will send to bear your gift to Jerusalem." 1 Corinthians was probably written about 6 months prior to 2 Corinthians. So here's a possible reconstruction, or at least something close to it. A year earlier, the Corinthians had said that they wanted to participate in this project. This commitment may have been made to Titus or to someone else who maintained contact both with Paul and the Corinthian congregation. Titus, we know, went back and forth from Paul to them a time or two. But after the initial commitment had been made a year ago, things happened that had gotten in the way and they hadn't followed through. We know what some of those things were. The things were the problems that Paul addresses in 1 Corinthians. A congregation with those problems and with that level of tension and division within the congregation could easily have failed to follow through on something that by its very nature was a cooperative effort. If they didn't even wait for each other to observe the Lord's Supper, and some of them were suing each other in courts, they could easily have not wanted to put their money into a common fund with each other. Paul's instructions in 1 Corinthians 16 were then intended to get the ball rolling again. But it still took some time to implement the reforms that Paul mentions in 1 Corinthians. Division takes time to heal. Correcting moral issues takes a lot of time and energy. Healing the Lord's Supper, correcting the unruly worship assembly would have been demanding. And even Paul, in that setting, would probably have agreed that, yeah, the collection can wait for a while. You've got more pressing problems to deal with. But now in 2 Corinthians, Titus has reported that things are doing better in the Corinthian church. So Paul feels that the time has come to get that collection back on track. But they still needed encouragement. So Paul uses the example of the churches up in Macedonia. If these churches could overcome their tribulations and get a collection ready, then maybe the Corinthians can overcome their recent history and do the same. A year or so later, after even 2 Corinthians, Paul wrote to the church in Rome, and it sounds like things in Corinth were in order by that time. In Romans chapter 15, verses 26 and 27, he writes to the Romans, "For it pleased those from Macedonia and Achaia to make a certain contribution for the poor among the saints who are in Jerusalem. It pleased them indeed, and they are their debtors, for if the Gentiles have been partakers of their spiritual things, their duty is also to minister to them in material things." So that gives us some of the background. Then in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, Paul gives what I'm going to call a philosophy of Christian giving. Actually, chapters 8 and 9 together are all about the collection. It's an extended passage on this topic. But in these opening verses of chapter 8 is where we can see what we might mistake for fundraising techniques. He brags on the churches up north in Macedonia about what they had done. If they can give, surely you Corinthians can match them. It could be taken as Paul trying to shame the Corinthians into giving. But there's also a completely different way to read this. True, he does use the churches of Macedonia as an example. But if a church, such as Corinth, has doubts about what they can do, considering their history, or if they have a history of repeated failure, knowing that other churches have overcome even greater obstacles would be totally appropriate, totally in order. So if we read this and if we assume that everyone is sincere, it really fits. For example, we know that the sincerity of the Macedonians was not in doubt. And Paul's sincerity shouldn't be in doubt either. After all the effort that Paul had put into helping the Corinthian church sort out and solve problems, his genuine faith and his genuine concern for them should be firmly established, that he really has their best interest at heart. And if Paul now thought that the Corinthians were sincere in wanting to do the right things, a bit of encouragement is more than appropriate. We have to remember that Paul is an apostle, someone devoted to helping people live right with God. He was investing his life in the spiritual development of these churches. He was an apostle first, and a fundraiser only second or third or fourth. He certainly hadn't consulted a fundraising expert to figure out how to craft the best fundraising letter possible. The poverty of the Macedonian churches also plays a role in this, because he refers to them and how they had given in spite of their poverty. The Macedonian churches would be Philippi, Thessalonica, and probably Berea. These were churches that Paul had started on his second missionary journey, had visited them when he came back on his third journey, and all of them were started in the face of serious persecution. Philippi was the first that he started in that area, and that's where Paul and Silas were flogged prior to spending a night in the dungeon. He was then run out of Thessalonica. He went to Berea. Things were going well in Berea until people from Thessalonica followed him to stir up trouble in Berea as well. But in 1 Thessalonians, the first chapter, he makes reference to the hardships faced by the church in Thessalonica. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. And he's writing to the Thessalonians, "And you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became examples to all in Macedonia and Achaia who believe." Then over in chapter 2, verse 14, "For you, brethren, became imitators of the churches of God which are in Judea in Christ Jesus. For you also suffered the same things from your own countrymen, just as they did from the Judeans." So we know that converts in the cities of Macedonia had faced open persecution. And earlier I suggested that part of the reason for the poverty in the Jerusalem church could have been the economic isolation of the Christian community in relation to the rest of the city. Well, that could well have been the case in Macedonia. And if so, that in part would explain their solidarity with the Christians down in Judea, if they has, as Paul said, suffered the same persecutions in Judea that the Macedonians had, the Thessalonians had suffered up in Macedonia, cut off economically and socially from everyone around them. So I don't think it's fair to Paul to assume that he is using the example of the Macedonians merely to manipulate the Corinthians. He is genuinely using a good example, first of all, of Christian thinking and Christian behavior to help a struggling congregation in Corinth do the same. Keeping this in mind, part of the problem in Corinth was trying to live as Christians while still thinking like people of the world. That doesn't work. So the Macedonians are here presented as people who were successfully making the transition to be spiritually minded people. That was a good example for the Corinthians to know about. The difference is shown in the perspective and the language that Paul uses. He says in verse 2 that the Macedonians faced, this is in 2 Corinthians 8, the Macedonians faced a great trial of affliction. But they also had an abundance of something. They had an abundance of joy and abounded in the riches of liberality. Moreover, brethren, we make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberality. They had an abundance of joy and abounded in riches of liberality. Those are spiritual fruits that God was producing in their lives. Those fruits grow when people are transformed by the renewing of their minds. It was happening in Macedonia. He wanted it to happen in Corinth. Joy and liberality are what a Christian gains when he is more concerned about laying up treasure in heaven than on earth. The Macedonians were making progress in that area, and Paul wanted to encourage the Corinthians to do the same. There is a bit of nudging or pushing on Paul's part. He understood the strengths and the weaknesses of the Corinthian church. But compared to some of the other things he wrote to them, this doesn't come close to being a rebuke, not at all. But it is a bit of a challenge. He understood that the Corinthians needed some prodding, some encouragement. So that's what he gives. But this was more about them making true spiritual progress than about an amount of money that Paul hoped to get out of them. Two ideas are woven through this passage and may not be completely obvious to us. The first one is grace. Four times in these seven verses, 2 Corinthians 8, 1 through 7, four times in these seven verses, Paul mentions grace. Now, we usually connect the idea of grace with the forgiveness of sins. And it's true that we are saved by grace. But grace is more than only the forgiveness of sins. In fact, of the four times that Paul mentions grace in these verses, forgiveness of sins is never the primary thought. In chapter 8, verse 1, he speaks of the grace God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. That would indirectly include, of course, forgiveness, but that's not Paul's focus here. The grace of God, he says, was shown in the abundance of their joy and in their liberality. In other words, it is a gift of God's grace to be able to rejoice in difficult times. It was out of the grace of joy that the Macedonians participated in the collection project. The next use of grace is obscured in nearly every translation, and I say nearly because I didn't check them all. It was in all of them, obscured in all that I checked. In verse 4, the New King James uses the word gift, imploring us with much urgency that we would receive the gift and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. The NIV there has the word service, that we would accept the service. But the word there is exactly the same Greek word that is translated grace in verse 1. What's happening? They pleaded with Paul to accept the grace that God had given them to be able to join in the effort. The same idea comes through in verses 6 and 7 where grace is mentioned again. So we urge Titus that as he had begun, so he would also complete this grace in you as well. But as you abound in everything, in faith and speech and knowledge and all diligence and in your love for us, see that you abound in this grace also. So there at the end of verse 7, he expresses his desire that they would abound in this grace also. As spiritually minded children of God, they had been liberated from worldly selfishness and had received the grace of generosity toward others. For the Macedonians, it was a gift from God to be able to join in Paul's relief project and help their brethren down in Jerusalem. Another important word that is often overlooked in this passage is fellowship. Also there in verse 4, imploring us that we would, that with much urgency that we would receive the gift and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. There the NIV, I think, has sharing instead of fellowship. This is one of the major, I think, overlooked features of our giving. We think of the Sunday offering as giving back to the Lord a portion of what He has given to us. That's true enough, and I have no objection to that idea. That's a correct idea. We also talk about the need to support the work of the church through the Sunday collection. That is also a good, valid idea. But the Bible emphasizes the fellowship aspect of the collection. The collection is an act of fellowship. Fellowship is from the Greek word koinonia, and it is used more often in the New Testament in connection with financial fellowship than fellowship in any other context. When we put money in the basket, we are demonstrating the fellowship that we have in Christ with each other. If a group of us gets together to do some church ministry, we see the fellowship aspect of it. We may work around the building. We may go on a mission trip together. And we know that we've done a good work, but we also recognize and are very appreciative of the great fellowship that we had while we did the work because we were working together. When we put our money in the basket, we also express fellowship in accomplishing whatever the money pays for. I can do good things with my money, and that's fine, but there's a lot more fellowship involved when we put our money together to do something that our group is doing collectively. And if there was anything the Corinthians needed to do better, it was to have fellowship with each other in doing good. For the Corinthian Christians, the whole process of participating in Paul's relief effort was a part of overcoming the other spiritual problems they had in the congregation. We know there was a big unity problem that's described in 1 Corinthians. Coming together on Sunday would help build unity. Putting their money into a common fund with each other would help unity and express fellowship and trust. Being willing to contribute instead of keeping it all for themselves would help develop a more spiritual and less earthly frame of mind. And in addition to all that, it would also help the Christians down there in Jerusalem. So Paul says, so we urge Titus that as he had begun, so he would also complete this grace in you as well. The money was important. The good intentions of the Corinthians wouldn't help the Judean churches a whole lot. But the money needed to be the result of spiritual growth in the Corinthian church. Fundraising gimmicks and pressure tactics would not accomplish those spiritual goals. So the application here is the collection for the churches in Jerusalem, but this is really a spiritual issue of seeing the Corinthians grow, seeing them grow together, come together, get rid of their division, get rid of their distrust of each other, and work together in this in this collection thing, but it was a spiritual thing more than a monetary one. The monetary was just sort of the bonus out of it for the Jerusalem Christians. We'll continue, Lord willing, our studies in 2 Corinthians as we go forward in the coming weeks. If you have not put on Christ in baptism or have been struggling possibly with this whole thing of learning to think about life more spiritually and less as the world thinks and need the help of the church in doing that, let us know. Let's stand, let's sing.